Alright, Mr. Nygren here. So this is War Leaders Clash of Nations. So I played this game back in 2009, it released in 2008, it's very similar to Medieval Total War Kingdoms. Unfortunately it had a lot of issues with CTD or crash to desktop, it wasn't stable. But on my old gaming computer I could play it fine, as long as I was prepared to start it up every now and then, because during the campaign I believe custom battles worked fine, but in the campaign If you attack too many on the same turn, you risk having to redo everything, because you can't save the game between battles. You can save the game before you end the turn. So if you end the turn and then there is like 10 battles, then it might crash on the 5th or 7th battle and then you have to replay all of them. So that's why you shouldn't attack too many factions at the same turn. Because I tried to play it, and I'm happy to say now that it's pretty stable, but custom battles are 100% fine, and campaign was also very stable. I played over 7 battles in a row, but then on the 8th battle, I believe, out of maybe 11 or something, it did crash, or so I had to exit. So I can't or should avoid to attack too many in the same turn, because otherwise I risk having to replay everything. So what you need to do when you play the campaign is that you need to maybe only attack a few areas each turn, so you don't risk the CTD, because it might still CTD randomly on ending turns, but it won't CTD the next time when you restart it. So, but unlike Medieval 2, you can't save before the battle, you can only save before you end the turn, so you risk having to replay 7 battles if you have too many battles to fight when ending the turn. Okay, and of course we're gonna play the campaign, but we will check the details here. So we have HDR, high dynamic range, more realistic image, light quality, bloom, improves the general image quality, and aliasing, same as Medieval 2, I don't need to have it I can't have it higher, okay. We don't need widescreen on. Textures. So we can have ultra high textures. I believe the capitals will crash, they will lag no matter what, because they are packed with cities. That's why I made the LOD control the lowest possible. So, level of detail to control the quality of models in polygons according to their distance. So if I have this on max, I can have super quality on models at very far distances, while if I have it over here, they will have the lowest possible quality when you're far away, and that's good, because that made the capitals not lag when I have zoomed out view, but unfortunately it will lag when I am zoomed in. They are very detailed and packed. Okay, we have create infantry extras on. We'll be able to see drivers in their vehicles and commanders in their tanks. I think that's a cool feature. Destroyed vehicles remain, of course. Allows destroyed vehicles to remain on the battlefield. Yeah, I don't like when they randomly disappear, like in Age of Empires or Battle of Middle Earth. Allow the corpses of dead soldiers to remain in the battlefield. So this is dead soldiers remain, and this is vehicles. I like both of them. And destruction pieces permits shrapnel to fly off objects that receive impacts or that are destroyed. Okay, yeah, I like all of them to be on. As for the texture quality, they could change it to ultra high. No problem. And then we have the trees detail on high, grass detail on high, ground holes detail, visibility of ground holes, okay, it's on high, and water quality on high. We could have it on ultra high, but it might, we could change that. Shadows, exteriors, visibility on the battlefield outside the game zone, we don't need that. Exterior objects, visibility of objects outside the game zone, we don't need that either, because it might lag more in making habitals, it's unnecessary. Same with the shadows, but appearance of shadows for all objects. It might be more laggy with shadows, but we could use shadows. Visual effects on high. Quality of visual effects in general. Shoot traces, activate shoot traces, vehicle traces, yeah. Like, yeah, when they move and such, I like that. Dust effects, activate dust effects of vehicles in motion, that's good. Visibility of environmental effects, okay. Camera, far plane, maximum distance of which the scene can be viewed in general. Maximum distance in which the objects can be viewed. Yeah, but I like it on low to reduce the lag in the capitals. As for the campaign, appearance of coastal wave effects, raw materials, visibility of raw material symbols over territories, that's good. Visibility of trees and shadows. Yeah. We will keep those on. I don't really know what the vertical sync is doing. Activate screen painting, vertical synchronization. I don't really know what it does. Maybe I do want widescreen after all. Okay, game setting. So we won't have armies creation on automation. So we won't have armies creation on automatic. Not building either. I like doing my own building and armies construction and creation. Technology research, we will also do that ourselves. Tax collection can be unautomated. Okay, fog of war. Fog will hide enemies' territories content. Yeah, that's fine. Use of oil. Vehicles need oil to move, that's fine. Use of raw materials. Raw materials are required to construct. Okay, I don't think I need that. Might be too hard. Use of regime affinity. Your territories will be affected by its population. Affinity, I don't like that. It will just lead to revolts. Use of morale. Morale will affect the effectiveness of troops in battle. Yeah, I like that. Trading of technology. It allows us to trade with other factions. There are only main factions. All the minor factions have the same boring units. They are represented with their own flags, but only the main factions can be played, and only the main factions have unique rosters of troops. Fast unit speed will be on, but we could have skip on fast unit movement when changing turns. Units move, yeah, we will skip that because otherwise it might crash during their turn. Let's check battle. Could have this on low, then it won't lag as much in capitals, but it's kind of boring to just see a few units. I prefer to play on large. I believe if I play on huge, it will actually lag. In my worst computer in 2009, I believe I could use huge and it wouldn't lag at all, but that's because back then I believe the graphics weren't as good, even when we had them on max. But with the better graphics of this computer, for some reason it lags when we have it on max. We will go for large unit size instead of huge, and we will use fuel, we use ammo, we will use morale, use of mines. Mines cannot be used if we deselect this, but I like that too. Weather will be always clear if we deselect this, but I don't want the weather to be always clear. Minimap rotation. Yeah, we can move the minimap, that's good too. Alright, let's accept. So I tried to play this in, I believe I played German campaign to the end in 2009, but I didn't record. I only recorded two episodes. They are still on my channel, probably re-uploaded in 2010. Then I played a Soviet Union campaign, and all the episodes were on my YouTube channel, an older channel, but it got removed. Okay, so I lost all those episodes. I didn't have any backups, but I didn't speak in any of those videos, because back in 2009 and 2010 you didn't speak, you only played and uploaded the videos that were 10 minutes 49 seconds each. So I basically just play the game as much as possible until I had no room left, and then I uploaded 11 minute videos. And then when I had uploaded all the material, I played more until I had no room left, and then I uploaded. But now I need to speak, because that's how Let's Plays are done these days, so it's more work. I need to speak and comment everything, and that's of course annoying to do for long periods of time. That's why I can't just play an endless amount of time and speak. I need to take pauses. That's why I also play different games too. But anyway, we are gonna play German campaign, single player, World War II. We have quick battle and custom battle too. It's like Medieval 2. The only difference is that you can only choose your own troops. You can't choose the enemy's troops. You can pick four factions. A custom battle, you can choose a battlefield including the settlement. You can choose the unit size, and if you want mines, morale, ammo, fuel, time of day, weather. And you can choose two game modes. Annihilation, it means that each side needs to kill off the other side, kill every unit to win, and kill the generalist. Then you just kill the general, because the general is represented by one guy. Okay, you can only have four factions instead of eight, like in Medieval 2. You can place the money here. You can have two to four factions. Click here, you can choose anyone. But the bad thing is that they only allowed you to choose your own troops. If I pick, for example, Italy here, then I can choose Italy's troops. I can choose which faction I want to fight as against or together with. If I place them in the same team, they will be allied. Okay. And then I can choose a general, or I can and promote him so he becomes very good. Or I can skip that and just add ordinary troops. We have infantry, we have tanks, we have anti-tanks, we have anti-aircrafts, aircraft, transport, artillery, reconnaissance, and the general. Okay, so we can add troops. We don't need a general. Okay, I clicked the wrong button there. Anyway, we can choose Italy's troops, and that's the faction we are playing, but we cannot choose our allies' troops or our enemy's troops. And when we click start after we have chosen our army, then the enemy and the ally will be chosen by the AI. And that's a really bad thing, I think, that I didn't like in this game. A quick battle is just like in Medieval 2. Then we had the multiplayer campaign in this, but unfortunately there were no TCP/IP LAN. Instead it used GameSpy, just like Medieval 2. The difference is that Medieval 2 and Rome Total War, they had the option to play LAN through TCP/IP as well, while this game only had GameSpy, and GameSpy went bankrupt or something. And that's why their servers were taken down, so now you can't play multiplayer anymore. But one thing I thought was cool with this game was that it had a multiplayer campaign. You can play, if you had two games by users, then you could play with a friend in the campaign. While Medieval 2 and Rome Total War only allowed hot seat campaigns in the campaign, where you shared the screen, but they didn't allow you to play from different computers. But I tried it, I believe, in 2011 between both of my stational computers and the laptop, and I believe that real-time battles didn't work, if I'm not wrong. I think only auto-resolves were possible, so in other words, it ended up being about the same as hot seat. So I was disappointed, but now I can't even play that because GameSpy disappeared. Okay, so in 2018 in January I uploaded two episodes with Germany, but the game would crash each time after I won a battle. I couldn't win a battle, it would crash immediately upon returning to the map, either on the loading screen or a few minutes after returning to the map, so I had to give up and uninstall the game. But now it worked. I played for many turns and and I could play battles. It can still crash when ending turns, when starting battles. It's when I start a battle, sometimes the startup screen, it's a white screen, and then your army shows up, and sometimes it will lock itself on the white screen and you won't get to the army. So anyway, so the faction in the game that you can play as, so you are playing as the faction leaders. The game is named War Leaders Clash of Nations because you are controlling the faction, but you are also controlling the leader. If the leader is captured, if he is captured in a region, then you lose the game. So the enemy doesn't need to take all your areas, they just need to kill, for example, Hitler to win. Okay, so you have two goals: one, conquer the other factions, and two, keep your leader alive, otherwise you lose. If he is captured, that means he's killed, then you lose the game. So you have Germany, Adolf Hitler, you have Hideki Tojo, Japan. Hideki Tojo was the prime minister in Japan, executed after the war, blamed for the war crimes. He was the leader of the military, but he isn't the emperor. The emperor was named Hirohito. I said that in the other video too. So Hirohito survived until the 1980s and wasn't really blamed for the war, even though I believe the emperor had some real power back then. It's just that he was seen as a living god, and instead Hideki Tojo was the one who got the blame after the war. Okay, we have Benito Mussolini, Italy. We have Franklin D. Roosevelt, USA, United States of America. We have Winston Churchill of the United Kingdom, the British Commonwealth of Nations, also known as the British Empire. We have Joseph Stalin and the USSR, United Soviet Socialist Republics, also known as the Soviet Union. We have Charles de Gaulle, France. He wasn't really the leader in 1939. He was the leader of the Free French after they lost to Germany. But in this game he is the leader from the start. But their real leader was just some ordinary politician, I believe. Also Pétain, a war hero from the First World War. He took over after France had lost to Germany, but this game starts in 1939, so it's before France has lost, but it's still led by the most known guy in this game. They choose de Gaulle because he is known as the champion of the French. He became president after the war. Okay, so Germany. Son of a customs agent, Hitler was born near Linz, Austria on April 20, 1989. A brilliant pupil at primary school, he did not complete his secondary education, left school at the age of 16. He subsequently developed a fruitless interest in painting and architecture. At that time, his antisemitism was awoken and continued to develop a favorable atmosphere. In 1939 he moved to Munich, Germany, thereby evading military service with the Austro-Hungarian army, which he saw as led by Jews and Hungarians, and in the hope of finding new opportunities. In 1914, at the beginning of the First World War, he enlisted as a volunteer in the German army, serving in France and Belgium. He was awarded the Iron Cross, both first and second class, fell wounded and was promoted to corporal. Serving in the war became a fundamental life experience for Hitler, and Germany's capitulation in 1918 impacted heavily on him and caused him great irritation. This ultimately led him to subscribe to the conservative myth, stab in the back. Okay. He maintained links with the army for some time, spying on leftist activity within the ranks until his incorporation into extreme right-wing circles in Munich, consisting mainly of ex-combatants. In 1921, creation of the Nazi Party was formalized, and in 1923 he organized an attempted coup known as the Bierhall Putsch, which ended in failure and Hitler's incarceration. During his imprisonment, he wrote Mein Kampf in an attempt to malice his thoughts. In 1924, Hitler became the undisputed leader of the Nazi movement. In 1929, the economic depression and discontent with the Treaty of Versailles instigated the formation of the Nazi Party. Following defeat in the 1932 elections, Hitler initiated a campaign of disturbances which eventually forced von Hindenburg to ask him to become the German Chancellor in coalition with other parties. He obtained victory in the 1933 elections and assumed the leadership of the state in 1934, whence he proceeded to neutralize all internal and external opposition to the Nazi Party, by then the only legal political party. The rearmament of Germany began in 1935. Compulsory military service was reintroduced and territorial claims began, aimed at overcoming the humiliation suffered in 1918. As a result, Rhineland and the Sudets were reoccupied and Austria annexed. In March 1939, the Czechoslovakian state was dismantled, with a German protectorate over Czech and an allied interim government in Slovakia. This time, 1939, Hitler was still not renounced all his territorial demands. At this time, 1939, Hitler has still not renounced all his territorial demands. Best unit, Panzer IV Tiger. Strengths, armored vehicles, panzers and submarines, Wolfpack. Weaknesses, few territories and initial resources. Okay, and here's the location on the map. So Germany is pretty small compared to the Soviet Union and US and others. Britain is also vast. You can see Japan, there's Manchuria, that's why they are pretty big. Italy has areas in Africa, so they are also pretty big. And of course, US is mainland US, they have Alaska, and then they have a few areas down here, like the Philippines. The United Kingdom, or the British Empire, they have Australia, they have New Zealand, they have India, Africa, and other areas in the Middle East, they have Canada, so they are really huge, and then of course Soviet Union, really big too, and France has a lot of areas in Africa, they have this area too, and they have Indochina. And the best unit of the French, RL-44, best unit of the Soviet Union, T-34-76A, a tank, best unit of the UK is paratroopers, best unit of the United States is the B-29 Super Fortress bomber plane, and Italy has the Decima mass commandos, that's their best unit, and Japan has the Mitsubishi A6M20 fighter. It was the best fighter in the world in 1939 or 1940. But the US managed to get the hold of one of them, and then they could create that plane that was better than the Zero in every way. But it was the best when they started the war, and then a few years later it wasn't the best anymore. Okay, and Germany had the Tiger. Okay, Panzer VI Tiger. I might have said 4 before. Okay, and the story. After her defeat in the Great War, Germany was seeking a new identity and place in the post-Great War European scene after the rise and fall of Kaiser Wilhelm II. Following the Kaiser's desertion, elections were held to establish a constituted assembly, which agreed the foundation of German Democratic Republic, known as the Weimar Republic. The newly established regime had to resist coups such as the putsch of 1920 and 1923, led by military figures and members of Adolf Hitler's Nationalist Party. Meanwhile, in 1919, Communist Party of Germany's Germany's fight for a proletariat revolution similar to that which took place in Russia was aborted. I see. The government, consisting mainly of social democrats, was distinguished by its moderation with a jealous respect for private property and without rancor towards the civil servants of the previous regime. In terms of foreign policy, territorial losses and sanctions incumbent in the new frontier plans were not acceptable for the nation, naming them diktat. The French occupation of Ruhr in the face of non-payment of reparations was met by strikes in Germany and passive resistance by the population. After a severe increase in inflation in 1923, the economy was able to recover and the Dawes plan was put in action to pay off incurred debts. The ultranationalist movement, strengthened since the end of the Great War, became even more influential during the crisis of 1929. They were composed of war veterans and extreme right-wing groups and defended a program of nationalist regeneration. Such groups also presented demands on territories lost in the Treaty of Versailles, with a wider aim of creating vital space for the German nation. The main spokesperson for this movement is Adolf Hitler, as his party's leader. After suffering defeat in the 1930 elections, Hitler is named German Chancellor in 1933. Later succeeding Hindenburg as head of state or president. Von Hindenburg had the title of president. The arrival of Hitler to power has instigated the militarization of Rhineland, large-scale rearmament and compulsory military service with a view to reclaiming territories he believes should be an integral part of the German nation. Let's click next. Okay. So we could use an advisor. We can have difficulty on war leader, the hardest difficulty. We will high historical accuracy level on. So if I have low, that means it's a sandbox campaign. You can do anything you want. There are no alliances from the start. Anyone can ally anyone. Anyone can fight anyone. But in the end, you will have to fight everyone because they will declare war on you when you get too strong. Medium, then you start historical accurate with your allies Japan and Italy if you are Germany, and with allies if you are an allied faction, and then you can change your alliances, you can betray your allies, and you can do whatever you want, and in the end you will have to fight everyone because they will all betray you in the end. And high historical accuracy is you stay allied with your historical accurate friends in the war and then fight the others. And they can't betray you, and you can't betray them. And you can't ally the allies if you are an Axis power, or vice versa. Okay, and I think we will go for high. Fog of war could be on. Use of oil could be on. I don't really need raw materials. I think it could be too hard. Regime affinity, I don't need that either. Use of morale. Trading of technology, yeah, that could be on. Tax collecting could be automated. And I think we're done. We want to have the numbers at large. I don't know if we want huge. It might lag. We will do. I'm not sure. I played a custom battle on huge and both armies were fully sized, and I believe it lagged slightly. I think we will go for large. Okay, let's start the game. And also, I don't like the start of the game, that they do not have any armies. We will use some sheets to get all the structures that they had historically from the start, just like I did in 1942, and then we'll get some starting troops. September 1st, 1939.
continent and the looming threat of war scorching the world like a gunpowder trail.
All right, we have 5,000 in money. We'll need to add a few more because we want all the starting structures in every area. We have 685 in oil too. Okay, this advisor is in the upper left corner, just like in Medieval 2. The world minimap is a globe, very fitting, just like Hitler had a globe in his office in the Reich Chancellery. Okay, and we can zoom out, so the planet will be a globe too. Zoom in. It's the entire world. They were lazy with all the minor factions. Okay, they don't have unique rosters. So the advisor says, should I remember you that the buttons on the right side of the mini-world globe allows you to change the information filter active for the territories. You can also use the control key or the number keys 1 to 11 to activate the various filters. Okay. Yeah, we can control speed there. We can also click on this to speed forward to that location on the real world map, just like in Medieval 2. This is a world map here. So we have some menus. Here we have the Ministry of Economy and Trading. You can see all the details of the treasury. So we have taxes 2,787. Available credit 5,000. Average tax rate 60%. We can change it here. Automation of tax collection should be on. And you can see details like building maintenance 5,500, armies maintenance 2,397, total expense 2,897. Income 2,787. So we have a little more expense than income. That's not good. Initial cash flow. We risk going bankrupt. Initial cash flow. Yeah. Financial balance minus 110. Yeah, we are minus 110 each time. Cash flow forecast 4,890. Then we have raw materials. Oil reserves 685. Production 35. Consume 0. Oil balance 35, oil consume forecast down 685. Raw materials, so these are the raw materials, but we decided to not play with raw materials because I probably suck with it anyway. Then we would just not be able to recruit anything and it would be boring. Okay, let's move the ships. In this game we just move them like this by clicking on the ships and then clicking on the like area where we want to move them. It's more like Axis and Allies when it comes to movement on the map. Okay, we started with some troops, but far from the correct number in 1939. We should be strong enough to invade in 1939 and should have enough to be able to protect all the areas. We Germany was ready for war by that time. So we can check the other areas first. We have technology area. We can upgrade technology here. We won't use any cheats there. We will play like it's supposed to. Even though in real history, probably Germany and Hitler probably already had a lot of this stuff ready when they started the war. But we will play correctly. So we will just start with this one. It's a here, camouflage clothing. The need to avoid the detection by the enemy became obvious during the positional fighting and finally deeply penetrative assaults of the First World War. Under these circumstances, the armed forces abandoned the use of brightly colored uniforms for more moderate coloring. Camouflaging became necessary. This time, the textile industry has the capacity to produce and distribute mimetic garments that will aid our soldiers in action. necessary for training commanders and snipers. By the way, the voices in battle in this game are really, really annoying to hear. They sound really unserious, very childish. I have silenced the voices, so you won't have to be bothered by them. Plus, all the factions had the same English voices. Okay. So no voices this time. If we double-click on the territory, we get to this screen. Here we can see details, the area, population 2490, regime affinity 50, but we didn't play with it, so we won't have revolts. And we can see the buildings that we have constructed already. We have barracks for regular troops, and we have a port, and we have a shipyard. This place, you can construct some stuff too and recruit some troops. Okay, so here we have a cannon factory and a light vehicle factory, airfield, network of coastal guns, intelligence headquarters building, and a center for military research. I don't trust this game to be stable forever. I mean, it will probably crash every now and then, and I believe also in 2009 that I couldn't move past a certain point when I tried to play it as it was intended, so that's why we need to have a quicker, faster start than intended. So when I click on Alt and B, we will auto-recruit everything, but I need to click on the X after clicking Alt B. Then I return, and we have built all those buildings. And we have all of these. I won't build the rest. We can now get the medium vehicle factory and an aircraft factory, but that's not something I want now. So we got the buildings I just previewed. That means we can recruit some units now. We'll get one of each of these, including an agent. We can also get tanks now, we couldn't before. So we have the Wehrmacht infantry. The infantry is the army. The infantry is the army's basic weapon. Every soldier receives or should receive basic infantry training. Their main tasks are the defense of positions, attacks on enemy lines, and the occupation of territory. Infantry are vulnerable to artillery, mortar, and machine gun fire, as well as tanks and enemy aircraft. Yeah, they are really basic. We can place them in buildings and in bunkers in this game, so it's pretty cool. And they can lay down, they can run, and they can sit, etc. There are a lot of cool options with them. So that's the Wehrmacht infantry. Then we have the pioneers. The engineering corps is one of the basic elements of the land forces. Engineers form sapper and transmission units. Their duties, among others, are the laying and clearing of minefields and the repairing of vehicles. The training takes place in the barracks for regular troops. Okay. Then we have the medics, GI or German paramedic. Medical soldiers or officers are charged with aiding those wounded in combat. They will accompany your troops, providing first aid and ensuring the satisfactory recovery of all infantry units. They can become targets for snipers, as they are easily distinguished by the Red Cross emblem on their uniform. They are chosen from the new recruits and officers with medical knowledge and trained in the barracks for regular troops. Then we have the German machine gunner, MG gunner, machine gun gunner. The machine gun has been a basic infantry weapon since the Great War. This weapon's firing cadence endows it with great power and ability to form the basis of the defense of a troop, section or company of infantry. The soldiers charged with handling machine guns are trained with regular troops and not as an elite force. Okay. Then we have the German mortar gunner. Mortars reach an important status in war due to their aptness for attacking enemy trenches over short distances. Thanks to their curved firing trajectory, This light, portable weapon provides support to the infantry in both defense and attack. If well placed, preferably in an elevated position, the mortar is very effective against infantry in the open field and for bombarding entrenched positions. Yeah, it's a cool unit. Then we have the agent, German spy. Secret agents which have infiltrated enemy territory carry out one of the most dangerous yet necessary missions in order to aid strategic planning. The agents, who may be of civil or military background, undergo intense training in encryption techniques, subterfuge, languages and weaponry. Their missions are extremely diverse and include information gathering, technology stealing, elimination of targets, sabotage, counter-espionage, and protection. If they fail on a mission and are captured, they will be executed for spying. Okay, they are pretty much all the agents of Medieval 2 in one, with the exception of the diplomat, because we do not have diplomats in this game. Instead, there is a diplomat menu between the leaders. Okay, so we can get tanks here. We have only the first two. We have the Panzer 1 OSF-B. It's worse than the worst tank of Total War 1942. Okay. The tank debuted in 1916 during the Great War. Its first mission was to break static battle fronts, allowing the infantry to advance through the breach. Following the end of the conflict, important theoretical studies were carried out, which discussed what the tank's role should be and whether it could act as an independent weapon. The tank must combine three elements: mobility, armory, and weaponry. The combination of these elements permits mobile combat with great firepower and protection against incoming enemy fire of any nature. The tank is one of the most versatile of units and is greatly effective against any type of enemy vehicle or infantry. Tanks are, however, more vulnerable in enclosed spaces, especially in cities when confronted by enemy infantry and, of course, against anti-tank weapons. Okay, and the other one, the Panzer II OSF-F. This is the one that is in Total War 1942, the worst one. Same text here. No new text. Okay, but you can see that the cannon is different. It's one slightly bigger cannon compared to this one, having two smaller. I believe these are two machine guns, so they are, the tank is just firing a machine gun from two turrets. Well, this one has an actual tank turret, but a very small one. It won't do much damage to a good modern tank of the war. Okay, then we have this, I believe we are, check this 7.5 centimeter pack 40 artillery. Anti-tank, it's an anti-tank artillery. Anti-tank artillery must undergo constant renewal in order to keep a pace with the continuous developments in enemy tank armory and weaponry. They are vulnerable as they reveal their position when fired. It can surprise the enemy if well camouflaged. These cannons are also effective against terrestrial targets and can be towed into position by transport units. Okay. We'll recruit some of these too. And here we have some new stuff. We have the 10.5 centimeter EFH-18. Most lethal weapons in the Great War were field and heavy artillery. Artillery can be used to bombard enemy units and positions, impede enemy passage, confine the enemy in a determined area, interdiction, or to respond to enemy artillery. Accurate observations are essential for precise and effective artillery firing. Although traditionally transported by horses, these cannons can now be hooked up to a towed by mechanized transport units. Hooked up to and towed by mechanized transport units. Okay. Then we have this one. 15 centimeter SFH-18, same text, the different gun. get both of them too. Then we have this car, the SDKFC 222. Modern reconnaissance forces play an important role performed in the past by the cavalry. This role involves the exploitation of territory, detection of enemy units and positions, and acting as a rapid response unit.